Hello, Minnesota, and happy Thanksgiving. My name is Tony Hernandez, and welcome to the Tony Hernandez Show. Today's Saturday, November 30th, and I must say I'm a bit sore today because we had our fifth annual Hernandez family football game on Thanksgiving morning, and it was in Roseville. We were running all over the place, diving, tackling, and true Hernandez style, trying to win that game. So nonetheless, Team Hernandez won, and I thank you all for joining us today. I'm going to be in the studio today flying solo. Sam Wayne Pierce had some family obligations this weekend, and we had a couple guests lined up. Because it's Thanksgiving, it just didn't work out for them to come on, but we will have them on in the future. And we're going to have a special show today, and I really hope that you can stick with us for the full hour, because we're going to be talking about a very important issue that's near and dear to my heart as a Catholic, as a resident of St. Paul. And I am sure that you're aware of the controversies that have been brought about recently with the St. Paul Archdiocese, and in specific with the sexual abuse scandals and some of the cover-ups that have gone on. And, you know, I've done a lot of thinking and a lot of reflecting about what exactly it is that I believe that I should do as a Catholic, and what I believe that our local community should do here as well. And before I get into too many of the details, I just wanted to go over a couple different disclaimers, just to get everyone on the same page so that you can know where I stand. And as I stated, I am a practicing Catholic. I was baptized in the Catholic Church. I went to Nativity Grade School in St. Paul for 8 years. I went to St. Thomas Academy in Mendota Heights, which is a Catholic military school. Was married in the Catholic Church. Our baby boy, Maximilian, he was baptized in the Catholic Church. My wife and I, Leona and Max, we go to church every Sunday, and we also participate in the sacraments, try to go to confession as regularly as possible. Probably don't go there as much as I should, but I definitely try to get there on some type of a basis. And so I'm speaking to you as a practicing Catholic, as somebody who believes in the teachings of the Catholic Church, somebody who has faith, and somebody who is also obedient to that. And I also want to say that I believe that the vast majority of Catholic priests are good people. I believe that they have good intentions. I know many, many priests. I have friends who are Catholic priests, and there's just no doubt in my mind that the vast majority of Catholic priests, not only here in St. Paul, in Minnesota, and across our country and world, they have good intentions, and they also share the faith and the teachings of the church. So I wanted to make that clear, because I believe the people that we are talking about here are a very, very small minority. It's just a few people. However, the damage that they have done, not only to the individuals in which they abused, but the damage that they have done to the local church here, and the disunity and the confusion that's resulted, I believe, warrants people like myself and other leaders and community leaders and parents and teachers to stand up. And that's not to say that we have to go out there and judge other people's souls. And I don't even think we need to necessarily judge, if this is sin or if that's sin, because ultimately, none of us should be judging anybody. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't stand up for what's right. And more importantly, we also have to stand up to defend and protect those people who can't defend themselves, namely children, young people, and people who are in difficult situations, or individuals who are vulnerable. And it seems to me that those are the people who were taken advantage of by a small minority of people. That being said, priests are human beings. And, you know, a lot of times you hear people talk about, oh, well, the church is doing this, and look at what these few priests are doing, and they use that as an excuse or a reason to dismiss the teachings of the church, or to dismiss the idea of religion. And I think that that's wrong. And so we have to be able to separate that which is human and the nature of institutions and the nature of people versus that which is pure and that which is divine or holds divinity. And so that being said, when you have humans involved in something like organized religion or a church or an institution, you are necessarily going to get the same types of problems that you're going to get with any other type of institution, whether it's a government institution or whether it's something like the UN. But you find all these other examples where there's a hierarchy in an institution and then human involvement. You oftentimes see the same type of corruption that can occur, or the tendency to cover up, or those individuals who are involved in these institutions sometimes are so enmeshed in the actual institution and their focus, they lose focus in terms of their number one priority becomes protecting the institution, which leads to cover-up, which leads to manipulation of message and media. And that's what we're going to really focus on, is the failure of the institution and what I believe necessarily needs to happen as a result. And there's been a lot of people calling for the resignation of Archbishop John Nienstedt, who is in charge. He leads the St. Paul Archdiocese. These calls are growing. Other people are starting to communicate this. Many people have said that they're not going to donate to the church anymore. Some big money donors like Jim Graves has come out publicly and said he's not going to donate. I know personally some people who have talked to their pastors and have told them, you know, because when you donate to your specific church, whether it's St. Joe's or St. Mary's by the Lake or St. Andrew's or wherever, a lot of that money goes to the archdiocese, and people right now, and I believe justifiably so, have some serious misgivings about giving their money that's going to go to the archdiocese, and then who knows what's going to happen to that money thereafter. So we're going to address all of this, and we're going to talk about the facts surrounding the case, and we're also going to talk about what people think or where we should go from here. It's my understanding that Archbishop John Nienstedt has refused to resign. He hasn't made any allusions that he's going to resign. And what he decides from here remains to be seen. And again, I don't want to come off as I'm judging Archbishop Nienstedt. I'm not. I'm not convinced that he did anything wrong or failed to do anything. But the faith of the people has been jeopardized here in St. Paul, the faith of the Catholics. And the Catholic community is in disunity right now. And I believe that the best course of action would be for Archbishop Nienstedt to resign. It doesn't mean that he has to give up his faculties. I believe that he can still be a priest. But there, too much has happened, and too many old wounds have been reopened, and there's too much division. And I believe for the sake of the unity of the Archdiocese, for the unity of the Catholic community here in St. Paul and in Minnesota and across the country, we need to see strong actions taken to reform and to make sure that this type of stuff ceases to happen again right now. The buck has to stop right now. And I just don't see those actions being taken, and I actually see the division amongst Catholics widening, and I believe that that puts all of us at a risk in terms of our faith, because at the end of the day, what we want and is more people to take part in the church, more people to attend the Sunday services, and more people to go to confession and receive that sacrament. That would be, to me, the most important thing, and that's what needs to be saved because there's a lot on the line. So, Dallas, if you're going to, if you could put up the screen here, a lot of the issues came about from reporting from NPR, and I got their website up right here. This is one of the first articles that came out by their journalist, Madeline Baran, or Baron. I'm sorry if I didn't pronounce that right. But I'm going to go through this article here that really goes through a lot of the facts of the case, and then we'll go from there. So It says Archbishop John Nienstedt was in the middle of a heated political fight over same-sex marriage in February of last year when he learned of a disturbing secret hidden in the basement of the chancery. Pornography from a priest's computer, some of which appeared to depict children. Canon lawyer Jennifer Hasselberger had uncovered several computer disks in a white three-ring binder kept in the basement archives of the Chancery Building, the headquarters of the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis. It was evidence from a 2004 internal investigation of sexually explicit images found on the computer of the Reverend Jonathan Shelley, then pastor of St. Jude of the Lake Church in Matamidi. Hasselberger, a firebrand top official who joined the Archdiocese in 2008, notified Nienstedt of the evidence, which included a report at the time from a private investigator that found that many of the depictions could be considered borderline illegal because of the youthful-looking male image. What followed was a contentious year-long debate among top leaders in the chancery about whether the images met the legal definition of child pornography, according to internal church documents that Hasselberger provided to the police earlier this year and were obtained by NPR News. The documents shed new light on the Shelley case and provided a closer look at decisions that Nienstedt and former Archbishop Harry Flynn made to keep the matter quiet and to continue Shelley in the ministry. The disagreements and rationalizations are replete with citations of canon law, arcane Catholic process, and disputes of who knew what and when. Among the documents is a letter drafted by Nienstedt to the Vatican dated May 29, 2012, in which he worries that the images in Shelley's personal file could expose the Archdiocese as well as myself to criminal prosecution. Hasselberger was told the letter was never sent. I'm going to read part of the letter here. This is from Archbishop Nienstedt to the Cardinal in Rome, Cardinal Levada. It says, it's unclear whether civil criminal actions remain a possibility. The independent investigator to look into this matter concluded that many of the homosexual pornographic images viewed by this investigator and computer analyst could be considered borderline illegal because of the youthful-looking male images. It goes on to say that they could expose the Archdiocese as well as myself to criminal prosecution. These factors also suggest that a penal trial conducted in the Archdiocese or elsewhere within the United States is to be avoided. In a separate memo dated January 27, 2013, the Reverend Kevin McDonough, who headed the church's child safety program, told Nienstedt that at least four of the images were quite likely to be minors. He found no need to take further action because the images themselves were not pornographic, but enticements to make a further step to view pornography and appeared to be pop-up advertisements. Were Father Shelley to have clicked on such advertisements, he would likely have been caught in a law enforcement sting, McDonough wrote. A spokesperson for the Archdiocese declined to make Flynn, Nienstedt, and McDonough available for interviews Monday, and it told NPR last week he did not possess illegal pornography and expects to return to ministry. And none of the documents include direct statements by Shelley. Police didn't learn of the pornographic images until February of this year when Hasselberger made a decision that she now says ended her career. She reported the images to the Ramsey County Attorney's Office and resigned 2 months later. The St. Paul police investigation found no child pornography, but led investigator Sergeant William Gillett cast doubt on the findings. He noted that police never found the actual computer and they had to rely on discs from the Archdiocese. Whether these discs were given to me, were the actual discs or copies of those discs after asking for them, I do not know, will I most likely ever know, he wrote. The latest revelations about Shelley came as the Archdiocese faces mounting criticisms over its handling of allegations of clergy sexual misconduct, prompted by NPR News investigations that show Nienstedt and others dismissed Hasselberger's concerns about Shelley and failed to warn parishioners of sexual misconduct by a priest who later pled guilty to child sexual abuse. In recent weeks, victims backed by the nation's leading clergy sexual abuse attorney have called for a grand jury investigation of clergy sexual abuse in the Archdiocese. St. Paul police are taking a second look at the Shelley case, and the top prosecutor in Washington County, Pete Horput, vowed to follow the evidence wherever it leads. In a statement released Friday, the Archdiocese apologized for any harm caused by clergy misconduct. It is critical to understand that our standard is zero tolerance for sexual abuse of a minor or vulnerable adult and absolute accountability, the statement said. Last month, the Archdiocese announced plans to form a new task force to review procedures, child safety. Federal law prohibits possession of any image of child pornography. Minnesota state law requires priests to report to authorities any indication that a child has been sexually abused within the last 3 years. Withholding that information is illegal. Then it goes on to talk about canon law. Here it says, Hasselberger thinks the Catholic Church should have called police in 2004. Once they start talking illegal, you've got to call law enforcement, she said. They're the only people really capable of sifting through that and making those kinds of determinations. This is way beyond the scope of our expertise. The Archdiocese first learned of the priest's pornography when a parishioner of St. Jude of the Lake received the priest's old computer, found sexually explicit images, and reported the discovery to the Archdiocese. Church officials asked Shelley to hand over his other computers for examination. Shelley responded by smashing one computer with a hammer and refusing to turn over another, said Hasselberger, who reviewed a report of the examination. It was 2004, 2 years after the clergy sex abuse scandal had shaken the Roman Catholic Church in America. Parishioners across the country were stunned by accounts in the Boston Globe of how bishops transferred pedophile priests from one parish to another. Church leaders vowed to improve their response to allegations of clergy sexual abuse. Few played a more prominent role than Flynn, who served as Archbishop of St. Paul in Minneapolis from 1995 to 2008. At the height of the scandal, Flynn chaired the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops Ad Hoc Committee on Sexual Abuse. In an interview with CNN on June 15, 2002, he said, "The church has experienced a tremendous humiliation. We have experienced a tremendous purification. And out of this will come a stronger priesthood and a stronger church." 2 years later, Flynn sent Shelley to St. Luke Institute, a facility in Silver Spring, Maryland, that treats clergy with sexual and psychological problems, according to the documents. Clinicians found ample evidence for the possibility that Father Shelley has an ongoing problem with compulsive sexual behavior in his internet pornography use, the St. Luke Institute report said. Church officials also asked a private investigator named Richard Setter to review the case. Setter worked on the computer analyst, found 2,300 pornographic files on the priest's computer, along with an internet search history that included free naked boy pictures, according to a May 15, 2012 memo from Hasselberger to Nienstedt, which she based her review on the computer analysis. And it goes on, basically talking about some more discoveries. And, so that gives us a basic background of the initial reports that came out of NPR. There's the one thing that really stuck out in my viewpoint with this whole thing is where, they're talking about this borderline illegal activity, and it went unreported, and Archbishop Nienstedt never sent the letter to Rome, to that particular cardinal, and essentially, it somehow just disappeared and was forgotten about until NPR came back and started issuing these reports and digging deeper to find out, what specifically was going on. So at least there is one point where Archbishop Nienstedt made an active decision to not send some information that he knew about that he qualified as borderline illegal, and must have made the determination that it was not illegal. But as Hasselberger points out, is it the church's duty to determine what's legal and what's not illegal? And furthermore, if it involves pornography and child pornography, do they not have a duty to report that? I would say yes, but I guess this is what the whole controversy is about. But recently, on November 9th of this year, Catholics gathered at the St. Paul Cathedral to protest and to call out for the resignation of Archbishop Nienstedt. and we're going to line up and play a report from that. So Dallas, if we could do that, we might have to watch a commercial first. We'll see here. Where did it go now? Here it is.
At the St. Paul Cathedral, the place where so many find purpose and faith.
We who believe in freedom cannot wait.
A group of Catholics gather nearby for a different reason. They're looking for renewed faith in church leadership.
It's up to us as the laity to step forward and say enough is enough.
All are upset over recent revelations of sex abuse and a potential cover-up.
Hello.
But for Sean Plocker, it's personal.
I was abused by a person of God in God's house. I was abused in the church.
Sean says he spent a lifetime fighting for justice that never came.
It's been a cover-up from, and this has been going on for a very long time.
He and other churchgoers see the only opportunity for change in the resignation of Archbishop John Nienstedt.
It's time for some profound action, and the action that the Archbishop needs to take is to step aside.
While about 100 people are calling for him to step down, others have a different view. The Twin Cities is home to 825,000 Catholics, most not at today's gathering.
I don't think he needs to resign. I wouldn't call for that myself. I support him and what he's doing, and I don't think that he's shied away from that responsibility at all.
Today's calls for new leadership went unanswered, leaving a church divided.
It will be divided until he does pull someone.
So that's a report from KSDP, from a protest that was organized outside the St. Paul Cathedral a few weeks back. And one point that I want to make about that is, you know, as I stated at the beginning of the show, me being a Catholic, I have great hesitations talking on camera, live with you right now, about my feelings in terms of the leadership of the Archdiocese. As Catholics and really the culture and even the values instilled within the church are for Catholics to be good Catholics, to not speak out, to be obedient, to trust the leadership, and to just take part in the activities and sacraments that Catholics are meant to, and to really not speak out. And I share that same hesitation. I don't necessarily want to be talking about this particular issue, but I feel compelled because of the people who are victimized by this, and then also because I strongly believe that the Catholics here in St. Paul and Minneapolis, we cannot have this type of a division. There's been too much that has been brought to light over the last few weeks, last couple months, by the NPR reporting and other things that are in the media, to just simply ignore it. I have friends of family and family friends and people who aren't as vocal, but they are deeply upset and deeply confused by all of the occurrences and revelations that have come about, and they don't know what to do. I know a few people have taken specific types of action, like they're telling their pastors that they're refusing to donate directly to the church, that they're going to take their tithe money and they're either going to donate it to the parish school that's attached to the church, so that way they know that their money is going directly to the school. They're preventing their money from going to the Archdiocese. I also know people who are not donating on Sundays, and instead they're taking that money and they're donating to organizations like Mary's Place and Feed My Starving Children and other organizations. They're diverting that money and sending it to other organizations. So they're still tithing. They're refusing to give to the Catholic Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis. And really, you know, the more I think about it, that may be the only way that any change actually occurs, change in leadership. I think that if enough Catholics stand up and they refuse to donate until leadership change is made, we're not going to really see that. So if you see enough people, money talks, enough people refusing to donate to the Archdiocese and sending that money elsewhere, eventually we will see a change in leadership, but that is probably the only way that that's going to happen, because the nature of institutions and the nature of human beings are to protect themselves and their own self-interest. And, you know, it's a lot like politics. It's a lot like government. You hardly ever see public officials step down unless they get immense and enormous public pressure to resign. Without that public pressure, they're not going to do it. And they're also going to do things behind the scenes to divert attention away from any misdoings or wrongdoings or anything like that. So with that, we're going to bring up another example of a priest. This is a North St. Paul priest. Dallas, if you could line this one up. He's calling for an independent investigation. Oh, it looks like we have a phone call here. Okay, we can take a call.
Are you there?
Yes, hello, caller.
All right, hey, Tony, thanks for this great show, putting this on. I know it's a difficult subject, but I think if the church took responsibility for dealing with pornography, it wouldn't be an issue, but it's the cover-up. It's trying to protect an image when that image shouldn't be protected, because their own theology talks about the sinful human nature of man. Mm-hmm. And this goes right along with it. And so instead of covering up, expose it, deal with it correctly, and move on. And, you know, we need to stop these people that are not only violating the law, but their own moral code that they have themselves, and then move on. But it's because that isn't happening that I think the problem keeps festering.
I agree, and can I challenge you one step further, caller? And your name, sir?
Tim Kinley.
Tim, thanks for calling in.
You bet.
So, you know, one thing that's very prominent amongst Christians and Catholics in particular is this idea of forgiveness, right? Jesus taught us that we have to forgive 70 times 70, and he also told the famous parable about the woman who was about to get stoned to death for infidelity, and he made the famous line. He said, "He without sin, you cast the first stone." And, you know, these are all very deep principles that all Christians, I believe, should believe in and practice. And it can be confused, though, with what's going on here, because, you know, we're taught to forgive, and I believe that's a great teaching, and we're also taught not to judge others. And so there's this fine line that we have, especially dealing with conflict within the church, of, mm-hmm. you know, we don't want to go out and judge any of these priests who abused. You know, I mean, we can deem their actions as wrong, but none of us have any idea where their standing is with God and eternal life and all that kind of stuff. That's not for us to judge. And so how do people have that balance where we're forgiving and not judging, but at the same time drawing the line for what's right and what's wrong?
Yeah, thanks for asking. I think in those situations, Jesus told the woman caught in adultery, go and sin no more. Stop it. Mm-hmm. To the one where to forgive, repentance is required. That's how I read Scripture. In those passages where it says, forgive this person, that person is asking for forgiveness. They say, yes, I've done wrong. But if there is, I haven't done any wrong, I don't care about abusing a kid, we are to judge. Matter of fact, I disagree with this theology that we're to forgive everybody. We're only to forgive those who repent. And Jesus says, when he says, don't judge, lest you be judged. So therefore, go out and judge rightly. He doesn't say don't judge. It's how you judge. Mm-hmm. Judge rightly. But when a person says, I'm wrong, forgive them. But when a person says, I'm not wrong, I can abuse all the kids I want. There's nothing wrong with that. That you don't forgive, that you judge correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's how I would see it.
Yeah, and you know, I think that's a very fair and strong point that you're making here, and You know, it's something that I think a lot of us have to come to grips with and come to the realization with, because, you know, when dealing in these situations, the natural inclination of people in the pews is to keep their mouth shut, because you don't want to come off as being overly arrogant or judgmental, and it goes both ways, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, you do have to watch out for that, but you still have to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
So if a priest, if the teacher, you know, now teachers have this sainthood, you know, the way the our society tries to build them up. If a teacher's committing child abuse or child pornography, they need to be held accountable.
Mm-hmm.
And there's cover-ups on that because of all the financial lawsuits that are involved.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody's exempt.
Yeah, you're right about that.
I agree with your point. It's, you know, this attack on the Catholic Church, somewhat legitimate, but it also goes to every denomination. It also goes to every government. It also goes to every school district, legislature.
Mm-hmm.
It goes everywhere. And that's what's not the focus on the church, and the church is the only one doing this. That's just a bunch of baloney.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that it's not just them.
Yeah, you're right about that. I mean, look at the great example of Penn State. You know, their football program and Jerry Sandusky and you know, that you know, the point I made earlier is it's almost the nature of institutions. You know, the nature of an institution and those involved in the hierarchy and leadership, the nature is to protect the institution almost at all cost, and sometimes the cost is you know, little boys and girls and vulnerable people, and you know, that's really where the line is, and it seems that the institutions over and over and over again fail to protect the little ones, you know, but they're so great at covering up and protecting themselves.
Right, and that's where the checks and balances, not only in our governmental system, but in the church, needs to be there too. And I applaud these people for standing up and saying, hey, church, you need to deal with this, you need to deal with it rightly. But they also shouldn't go overboard either.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's checks and balances.
Yeah, very good. Well, I appreciate the call, Tim, and I'm gonna line up a clip here to show another person who is standing up.
All right, bye-bye.
Thank you. All right, Dallas, if we can line this up. This is a North St. Paul Catholic priest. He had an investigation done. He's calling for an investigation, and we can line that up right now.
He's new tonight. We start with a North St. Paul priest calling for new leadership in the local archdiocese. It's just one of the three suggestions Father Bill Deziel made in the Church of St. Peter's Church Bulletin. He wrote that the archdiocese needs an independent investigation to deal with two recent sexual allegations. Earlier this month, the Archdiocese announced a panel to investigate, but Deziel noted that the panel is led by a priest. He also says that the Archdiocese must release the list of 33 priests who it believes have been credibly accused of sexually abusing children. Deziel says it leaves everyone wondering who those men are and who may be a threat to children and young people. He also said the Archdiocese needs to open the so-called vault that contains files on priests with a checkered past, then allow law enforcement to inspect those files and make decisions on which ones contain criminal behavior. The findings should be made public and charges filed if necessary, he says. Finally, Deziel says that it may be time for a do-over with the archdiocesan leadership. He calls the steps dramatic and bold, but said short of these, the good faith and credibility of the archdiocese will be considered suspect or downright bankrupt for years. Also,
and that's a very good point that that priest from North St. Paul is making, and that really is the danger, is losing a whole generation, if not one or two more, of Catholics in their faith and credibility in the institution of the church. And really, to me, the only way that this is going to be restored and the only way that we can save losing these future generations is for leadership to take bold and decisive action, and also for the Catholic parishioners to take bold and decisive action. It doesn't mean doing anything outrageous. It doesn't mean doing anything unethical. What it means is standing up for what's right and doing what is right now. And again, Archbishop Nienstedt, he just may be a victim of circumstance and history that, you know, he is put in this position as Archbishop right now and having to deal with all of this. But you better believe that in any other institution, you know, whether it be a college athletic program or a college institution, or whether it's government or any other types of things, when conflict and scandal hit this close, you need to see new leadership. And that's why I believe that Archbishop Nienstedt would be doing us all a huge favor if he would resign and if new leadership could take place in the Archdiocese and we can open a new chapter in the Catholic Church in the St. Paul Minneapolis Diocese and really move forward with a very strong zero tolerance towards child abuse and sexual misconduct amongst priests. I don't believe that priests need to have a second chance. It doesn't mean that we're not going to forgive them, but if a priest is caught with any type of pornography, whether it's child porn or adult pornography, that priest should lose the collar, lose the faculties, get zero retirement, and be done, fired. That's just the way that I believe that it should be, and I don't think that there should be any this idea that you can reform sexual predators. You know, they may be able to, but you don't need to reform a sexual predator so that they can become a priest again. You know, I gave the example multiple times at my company or at your company or wherever people work. If you're caught with child porn or just any type of pornography on your computer, what do you think would happen to you in your job? You know, most likely, if you're viewing pornography at work or on a work computer, more than likely, you're going to get fired on the spot, and rightfully so. Does that mean that you can't reform yourself and you can't get another job or you can't cure your addiction? Of course you can. But at that particular job, you failed. You need to move on and you need to pay the consequences for that. So we have a caller. Is the caller on the line right now, Dallas? No, I don't think the caller is on the line, but a caller, I guess, called in and asked if a resignation would solve the problem. So I'm assuming that means, would the resignation of Archbishop Nienstedt, would that solve the problem of sexual misconduct in priests? And I believe that answer is no. I believe what the resignation of Archbishop Nienstedt would solve would be restoring a little bit more faith and a little bit more credibility in the leadership of the Archdiocese here in Minneapolis and St. Paul, and it'll begin some of the healing process for parishioners to move forward, to restore their faith in the leadership, and to really get past this chapter of shame for many, many Catholics in the area. So I hope that answered your question about whether or not the resignation would solve the problem of the sexual misconduct of priests. I don't believe that it would. I believe that it would start to solve the problem of restoring the credibility of the leadership and the institution and the Archdiocese of Minneapolis and St. Paul. Now, what needs to be done for the misconduct of these priests? Well, I'm not exactly sure because I don't know the whole process of becoming a priest and whatnot, but the zero tolerance would be a great place to start. You know, when we're new priests are in the seminary, to really hammer home the idea that if you get caught once, you know, whether it's legal or illegal, it doesn't matter, you're done. There's no second chance. You don't get your retirement. You don't get your pension. You don't get your income. You're back into the private sector with the rest of us where you have to deal with consequences for your actions. And maybe that sounds harsh, but, you know, like I said, at my old job, if it, or any of your jobs out there, if you get caught watching pornography on your work computer, what happens? You get fired. They don't give you a second chance. I mean, if you're lucky, you might, but chances are that you won't. So.
And they have these big red noses, and they're named things like Bobo and Crispy.
Okay. Now, let me...
I don't know where that one came from, but so we're going to move on, and we're going to actually review an article that was in the St. Paul Pioneer Press, and that is from a gentleman by the name of Ruben Rosario. He made. Hey Dallas, do we know where that sound's coming from? Okay, there we go. It's gone. So Ruben Rosario wrote this article. It looks like it was written on October 26, 2013. And he wrote this article, and then Father O'Gara, who is the pastor of Assumption Catholic Church in St. Paul, he wrote a homily that somebody recorded on YouTube, and I'm going to play that after in response to this. And I think some very, very good points are made here. So it says... Ruben Rosario says, to regain trust, Twin Cities Archdiocese will have to come clean. And he starts with a popular Greek saying, hide the truth and you hide Christ. It was 2002. A publicly embarrassing clergy child sex abuse scandal was unfolding in a large city on the East Coast. Take a wild guess which one. I'm guessing New York City, maybe. It wasn't long before Jonathan Bernstein's phone rang. Bernstein is a successful Los Angeles county-based crisis management expert. The folks at the other end of the conference call included the Archbishop, his spokesperson, and a church lawyer. They expressed interest in hiring his firm, but first wanted his general advice on how to best snuff out the inferno of bad publicity. Bernstein obliged. I told them that they needed to do three basic things: total candor, total transparency, and total humility, Bernstein told me last week. They said, thank you very much, hung up, and he never heard from them again. His advice went unheeded. The scandal got worse in ensuing months. The classic definition of insanity is repeating the same thing over and over and expecting a different result, as Bernstein reminded me during our chat. Same could be said for the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis, once again knee-deep in the scandal. We've seen this debacle played out numerous times here and elsewhere. Alleged mishandling or cover-up of years-old and ongoing clergy sexual misconduct and abuse cases has prompted a police probe and the creation of an independent review panel. It has led to the resignations of Archbishop John Nienstedt's second-in-command, as well as a former archbishop and a vicar general from the University of St. Thomas Board of Trustees, following allegations that a clergyman professor had inappropriate contact with an underage girl years ago. Meanwhile, there are increasing calls for Nienstedt to perhaps step down in favor of new leadership. A beloved religious institution whose main mission is saving souls may need a little saving of its own. So he's offering some free advice here. So what to do? Well, if doing the right thing hasn't been too obvious by now, do what large and smart corporations do. Swallow hard and hire a crisis management team like Bernstein's. Reports are that the Archdiocese is shopping for such a firm to repair its bruised reputation. One name tossed about is Rasky Bayerlin, which won a public relations industry award for organizing a meeting between Boston church officials and sex abuse victims a few years ago. I don't know what else they did, but I bet they pocketed a lot of collection plate donations for the job. The Twin Cities Archdiocese has also reportedly looked into bankruptcy as an option to protect itself from loss of revenue and lawsuits that may come. Well, given that many parishioners I know are concerned that their donations are going to pay lawyers instead of caring for the poor and vulnerable, I persuaded Bernstein to give local church leaders some advice on the cuff. That means free. He obliged once again. Archdiocese, he told me, keep making the same errors in part because of arrogance and self-denial. Those are critical barriers that also play out in large corporations, Bernstein said. In this instance, the attitude is that only the church can decide what is wrong. And if the church can hide it, they will hide it. Withholding information from the police, much less the public, is not good And it's clear, based on what I've read, that they did that. He says, you need a human face. The local dust-up came after a Minnesota public radio investigation, assisted largely by a former archdiocese canonical affairs lawyer turned whistleblower, disclosed that Nienstedt and other top officials failed to warn parishioners of one priest's sexual addiction. The priest, Father Curtis Waymayer, former pastor of Blessed Sacrament Church on St. Paul's East Side, was convicted and sentenced to 5 years in prison for sexually abusing two children and possessing child pornography, among other things. In other publicized cases, the Archdiocese kept secret what Nienstedt described in an unsent letter as borderline illegal pornography found on the computer of another priest allowed to continue with public ministry. It also provided bonus payments to another priest who retired after a civil jury found he had molested a boy. Again, they're paying him bonus payments, retirement, after a civil jury found he had molested a boy. Outrageous. The letter never sent to the Vatican from Nienstedt focused squarely on concerns that the mishandlings could expose the Archbishop to criminal prosecution. Given the larger scale pedophile and church cover-up scandals in San Diego and Los Angeles, which led to unprecedented nine-figure settlements, Bernstein said the local cases are small potatoes by comparison, but no less alarming. He guessed correctly that I'm sure by 99% that top officials are not giving media interviews because their lawyers have told them not to. Other than prepared mea culpa boilerplate press release statements or generic replies via email to questions submitted in advance by local media, Nienstedt has not made himself available to local TV or print media for a frank face-to-face chat. Why not? I don't know. Bernstein, who categorizes such arm's-length statements as more spin than substantial action, believes this is a huge mistake. You need a human face out there representing the church, he said. They don't understand that the court of public opinion can destroy you quicker than the court of law. Still, Nienstedt appears to have taken a small step in owning the crisis last week. In a column published Thursday in the Catholic Spirit, the Archdiocese newspaper, he said in an outside legal firm will review clergy files and pledge the commitment to honesty and transparency from now on. As the head of this local church, I know that the ultimate responsibility here is mine, he wrote. My heart is heavy with the agony that these errors have caused. Nienstedt's call for an outside review mirrors what whistleblower Jennifer Hasselberger implored him to do in her resignation letter more than 7 months ago. Hasselberger asked Nienstedt to take his responsibilities towards the protection of the young and the vulnerable seriously. She also recommended that he remove from ministry and make public a list of clergy who have been determined to have engaged in acts of sexual misconduct, as well as those whom could unreasonably be assumed to pose a threat to children and young people. Until this occurs, I do not believe that it can be said that the Archdiocese is honoring its promise to protect, Hasselberger wrote. Not surprisingly, Nienstedt's column was panned the same day it appeared by David Clohessy, director of Survivors Network of Those Abused by Priests. He does one thing today. He promises hiring more lawyers, said Clohessy, who along with the brother was molested by a priest when he was a teen. None of Nienstedt's words today protect one kid, expose one predator, discipline one enabler, uncover one cover-up, or deter one crime. But will they do it? Taking Nienstedt's comments at face value, Bernstein believes the column is by far the most effective piece of crisis communications issued by the Archdiocese since the current issues surfaced. But he cautions that similar remarks have been made before without much change. He cites the demise of Arthur Andersen, once one of the nation's major accounting firms, as an example of what not to do. Arthur Andersen folded after it was linked to a massive $100 billion fraud tied to Enron Corp. And Bernstein served as a consultant early on and gave the same advice he gave the church officials 11 years ago. They had the same mentality, he said. We can't do anything wrong, and if we do, we'll just cover it up. He believes the status quo will drive away parishioners, and I believe that too, and it'll erode trust in church hierarchy. They have to change their behavior, he said, unless the Pope, and forgive my language, essentially says de facto, cut this expletive out. They are not going to do it, and they will continue to make the same mistakes. Great advice. And he said it's free to boot. So that was a great article written by Ruben Rosario, bringing in some very pertinent examples, hitting on the idea that we were talking about earlier, the nature of large institutions. It's similar to big government. It's similar to big corporations, and the nature loses the humanitarian aspect of it, and they instantly go into defense mode and cover-up mode, and that is what is infuriating so many people. And, you know, he does say that, you know, at least Archbishop Nienstedt has taken some small steps. I believe that he's saying he needs to take further steps, become the face of this issue, engage the media, go out there and be human and be humble. But that's, in my opinion, is still not happening. And we're going to line up this homily that Father Stephen O'Gara is the pastor at Assumption Catholic Church in downtown St. Paul. And he wrote this, he gave this homily, and it went viral online, at least as much as it could for, you know, a Catholic sermon and whatnot. But let's play that up, Dallas, if you want to line this up. And he was actually, he gave this homily the day after Ruben Rosario wrote this article or had it published. So if we could line that up. And the audio quality, I'm sorry to say, isn't the greatest.
And the nurse is just blown away by this. And as Morris slips away, she says, Mrs. Schwartz, your husband must have been such a hardworking man to have accumulated all this property. Sarah looks back at the nurse and says, property? The guy has a paperwork. I think we often get confused about what is the reality of our lives and what isn't. That sounds like this guy accumulated a lot of property. We get confused with our perspective. But the gospel today is so clear in its message that I can't afford it. Here's the Pharisee standing before God, claiming all virtue before him. But thank God he's not like the rest of humanity, he says in his prayer. And then we have the tax collector, not even coming forward, but standing off to the side in all humility, thanking God for the simple things in his life. I don't know how you can't think of the archdiocese and what we are going through, really what we are being put through by those in power and authority. Isn't it ironic that we finally have a pope, it seems, that gets it? In a spirit of humility, he casts off all the trappings of his office and reaches out and touches literally the people who are in need, whether it be someone who's poor, someone who's lost, someone who's physically ill. And he makes it clear in his own words, don't worry about the small stuff. It's the big things that are important. He didn't say ignore the words, but he said don't emphasize and worry about it. And then we have the Pharisee. And I don't want to call anybody names. I've never gotten along with the Archbishop, so I'm coming at a different spot. And I'm not taking any blame in the fact that he's facing these challenges and difficulties. I feel it. But at the same time, what is all demand that he come forward? Clean slate. Stand before a venue of people, answer questions, tell us the truth. And then maybe, with that truth, we can forgive. But until we know the truth, it's not going to be through emails and letters of the Catholic Spirit. He needs to stand before us and explain himself. Only then can we have the respect called to his office. It's about arrogance. And we all fall victim to arrogance in some degree or some place in our lives. But this is more. This is not some small matter. This is a big deal. It's the first time, I must say, in 69 years that I'm embarrassed to be Catholic. I even thought, why do we do this? If this kind of stuff goes on. I think it's wonderful that you're here this morning. I think it's wonderful I came and showed up. Because in a lot of ways, I didn't want to. These are difficult days. They're hurtful, they're painful. And I think it's time we come clean. If you have a chance, read Ruben Rosario's article today at St. Paul. I think it sums it up. We can choose ourselves to be the Pharisee or the tax collector. We can choose the faith that's important to us and let the institution go by the side. We need our faith. We don't need the institution. It helps. It can help. But right now, it's certainly. And so just as St. Paul said to Timothy, the Lord will rescue me from every evil threat and will bring me safe to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever.
So that's Father O'Gara in Assumption Church, downtown St. Paul. He delivered that homily on the same day that Ruben Rosario had his article published in the St. Paul Pioneer Press. And it's better to hear the words from him because he puts it much more elegantly than I was able to put it. But essentially, what he is re-emphasizing is that we need our leadership here in St. Paul and Minneapolis within the Catholic Church to stand up, to engage us, to tell us the truth, to allow the truth to be told so that people can know the full nature of everything that has gone on and is perhaps still going on. We need to know everything that happened so that people's faith can be restored in the institution. That's not to say that people need the institution in order to have faith. He notes that it helps us to acquire our faith, but it is not a necessary component. However, if the Archdiocese, if Archbishop Nienstedt and the Catholic Church wants to restore the faith and the credibility within the eyes of the people here in St. Paul and Minneapolis, then we need to know the truth. And we need to deal with the truth so that we can make the necessary changes so that we can all move forward and have the faith and confidence that our children and our children's children and the vulnerable and the sick will be taken care of and not manipulated and taken advantage of. And we ask Archbishop Nienstedt to be truthful, to be forthright, and if he's unable to do so, then it's time for him to resign. I thank you all for tuning in. That's the end of our show today. You can watch our show on Tony Hernandez Show. That's our YouTube channel. Certainly invite you to go on there and subscribe and share our video if you can. May God bless you. May God bless America. And vaya con Dios.